Amen. In your Bible, we started talking about the high priest, right? The high priest. The high priest is here. We're going to bring the high priest out. Make some noise now. But don't come out yet, high priest. That was kind of weak. So, yeah, he definitely ain't going to come out on that. But turn in your Bible to Hebrews. Let me show you why I spend time and why we're going to spend a whole lot more time talking about these types of things. As you've heard me say, and you guys, if you've been around here for a while, you know that the entire Old Testament, and even some of the New Testament, Acts, the Gospels, the stories, they're all typologies. They're hidden. It's like a code. It's like things that are hidden in the Scriptures to give those who dig deep, who have a strong desire for them, they dig deeper and go after those jewels, those great jewels that are in the Scriptures. And so I want to dig into those a lot more because I believe you're ready for that. I believe that you're ready to dig in into those deep things. I remember years ago, I was, you know, of course I grew up in Word of Faith type of church, and after a while I was like, man, some of this stuff ain't working right. But after I started understanding grace and many of the things about grace, I thought, wow, this does really work. It really works. So I want to help you to do that. Are y'all ready for that? All right, let me just show you here why, out of the book of Hebrews, turn to Hebrews in chapter 8. Remember last week I read a few verses to you out of chapter 7, but Paul explains in Hebrews how every single detail of the Old Testament is pictures of the New Covenant. It's pictures of the truths of the new covenant in Jesus. And so he begins to explain some of those details. And let me tell you like this. The Jews, the Hebrew people today, are the wealthiest people on the earth. Of a nationality, of a one group of people. They're a small, and we went to Israel, I can't remember if it was last year or the year before, but Shanae and I went with Joseph Prince, and it was an awesome trip. But we found out a lot of the details about the country, and it is about the size of New Jersey. Small, small country, not a huge number of people, but the wealthiest people. The wealthiest people on the earth. And if you'll see in Exodus, when God delivered them out of Egypt, they were at that time, they left rich, they left all healed. In Psalms 103 or 105, maybe 105, it says that they all left. As a result, they came out of slavery as a result of the blood over the doorpost and the eating the roasted lamb. All of that is a picture of Jesus' blood and us eating his broken flesh or the sacrifice that he made for us, right? And that's why we take communion every week. And I'll teach that again so you understand, because healing is really there. That's how you walk in health and healing. And as a result of them eating that, they walked out of bondage that day. They walked out of poverty that day, and they walked toward their promised land. Now, they got stopped up in the middle of the way, but they ended up making it. But all of a result of a picture of the true. They got set free based on the picture of the truth. A picture. In other words, they were eating a roasted lamb and put blood over the doorpost of an animal, right? But it was just a picture. We have the real thing. And Paul explains in the book of Hebrews, he says, if their picture delivered them and healed their bodies, this true does much, much more. And what he's trying to explain is that if you'll really understand this new covenant, it's much better than the old. The old covenant, Deuteronomy 28, the blessing of God, y'all familiar with that? Blessed are in the city, blessed in the country, all that. The Jews were blessed because of the old covenant. He says this old covenant is as bad as, in comparison, weak as the in comparison to heaven compared to the tabernacle that was on earth. He said there's no comparison. So I want to show you this because if you'll embrace this, I want it to stir up a hunger in you to understand how great this new covenant is. It's better than you can imagine. He starts explaining. He explains the high priest in chapter 7. We read some of that last week. Come on, it's Bible study. So y'all ready? So we can dig in. And these are the things that cause us to elevate in life, to walk in health, to walk in abundance. It'll heal your body. Amen? And because you'll understand how much he really cares for you. Here we go. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 1. I'm going to read from the Amplified Bible. Let's go through the first six passages here or so. Amen. Look at this. Now, the main point of what we have to say is this. He just finished explaining the high priest in chapter 7. He said, now, the main point of what we have to say is this. We have such a high priest, one who is seated at the right hand of the majestic God in heaven. Right? As officiating priest, a minister in the holy places and in the true tabernacle, which is erected not by man, but by the Lord. And again, remember I told you that Hebrews is a comparison and contrast. So he compares the natural order of the Levitical priesthood to the high priesthood of Jesus, the Melchizedek order. Remember, we explained that. So he's saying, right, for every high priest is appointed to offer gifts. The high priest in the old covenant had to offer a lamb, right? He said, for every high priest is appointed to offer gifts and sacrifices. So it is essential for this high priest, talking about Jesus, to have some offering to make also. Next. If he then were still alive on earth, he would not be a priest at all. Because it's a different order. He's saying those high priests that were here were from what tribe were the priests from under the old covenant? Oh, what's up, girl? How you doing over there? Come on, give me some.
I didn't need me.
Oh, okay. Good to see you, precious. Watch this. Excuse me, y'all. So the old priest, let me see. Yeah, the old priest, the old covenant priest, what tribe were they from? Levites. Yes, they were from the Levites tribe, right? The tribe of Levi. Jesus is of the tribe of? Come on, no. Come on, tribe of? Line of the tribe of Judah. Yes, Jesus is of the tribe of Judah. Levite means law. What does Judah mean?
Praise.
So this old covenant was based on law. The new covenant is based on? Right? Jesus. But they want to show you why he's not from the tribe. And he's going to explain it here. Let me just read it. And if he were still on earth, he would not be a priest at all. For there are already priests who offer gifts in accordance with the law. Those are the Levite priests. He wasn't one. So Jesus wouldn't have been qualified to be a priest under the old covenant. He's from the wrong lineage. Couldn't be from, you'd have to be a Levite. He wasn't from Levite. And the reason was because it's a whole new order of priesthood. And that's what he's trying to show us here. But these offer service merely as a pattern. Those old covenant priests offer service merely as a pattern and as a foreshadowing of what has its true existence and reality in the heavenly sanctuary, right? For when Moses was about to erect the tabernacle, he was warned by God, saying, see to it that you make it all exactly according to the copy, the model which was shown to you on the mountain. Now, do you get this? Moses went up into the mountain for how long? 40 days and 40 nights, right? When he went up to the mountain, he went up there and he came back with what? 10 commandments. But it don't take 40 days and 40 nights to get 10 thou shalt nots. He was up there 40 days and 40 nights, actually two times. And what he got when he came back was he wrote the whole first five books, the first five books of the Old Covenant called the Pentateuch, five, Penta, right? He wrote the first five books, and it's all about Jesus. So it didn't take 40 days and 40 nights to talk 10 laws. It was all about Jesus. And this is why God's saying he told Moses, write it exactly like I tell you. It was details about the tabernacle, details about how to make the tent, how to make all these details of stuff. So he's trying to show us here, those things weren't just things. It's all describing these new covenant secrets. Watch. He says, but as it is now, he, Christ, has acquired a priestly ministry, which is much superior and more excellent than the old. As the covenant, He, Christ, has acquired a priestly ministry, which is as much superior over that old priesthood, right? And more excellent than the old as the covenant, the agreement of which he is the mediator. He says he's much more superior as a high priest, the same way the new covenant is superior to the old covenant. You get what he's saying? Come on, are y'all following me or is this too deep? You get it? He's saying he's superior, and so is this new covenant that he comes with. Say, I'm a new covenant believer. All right. Now, what I just said was the old covenant made the Jews the wealthiest people on the earth. They still don't believe in Jesus. They believe in the old covenant.
Come on. Come on.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Come on. Come on.
If the old covenant has made them the wealthiest people on the earth today, still, 2,000 years after Jesus came, can you get what he's trying to show us? This new covenant is crazy, the bomb. It's so much superior. All right. Watch this. As the covenant agreement, of which he is the mediator and arbiter, agent is, next, superior and more excellent because it is enacted and rests upon more important, sublimer, higher, and nobler promises. He said the new covenant promises are better. So the high priest has to be better. All right. Now, glasses. Then he goes on. Look at verse 7. Can y'all do all that? Yeah, hit verse 7. For if that first covenant had been without defect, what he's saying is, remember, it's a comparison contrast. So the first covenant, if it had been without defect, there would have been no room for another one or an attempt to institute another. But what he's saying is that first covenant did have defect. So he brought in this new covenant, which has no defect. Why? Because the high priest has no defects. Are you with me? How are we? He finds fault. Okay, he goes on and says that. Jump on down to chapter 9. Chapter 9, verse 1. Now watch this. Let me just read a couple verses here. Y'all all right? Even now, the first covenant had its own rules and regulations for divine worship, and it had a sanctuary, but one of this world, right? For a tabernacle tent was erected in the outer division. So he goes on and breaks down, starts explaining just the parts of the old tabernacle. Outer court, inner court, holy of holies, and the articles that were in it. That's what he goes down to break down, all right? Go on down to verse 9. Amplified, please. Seeing that the first outer portion of the tabernacle was a parable. A visible symbol or type or picture of the present age. Okay, y'all see what he's saying? He's saying, so all this stuff was not just tents and lambs and stuff. It's a picture of a parable of this new present age of covenant. Are you getting it? So that's why it's important that we spend the time looking at it, because these, in fact, if you read the last verse in chapter 7, you know how to do it, but he says, he kind of touches on it. He says, these things, I can't even go into detail here. Why? Because they're all in the Old Testament hidden. It's great truths. All right? Seeing that the tabernacle was a parable, a visible symbol, or a type, or picture of the present age, and its gifts and sacrifices are offered, and they are incapable of perfecting the conscience or of cleansing and renewing the inner man of the worshiper. He said that old stuff wasn't perfect. It couldn't make your conscience perfect. So what is he saying? The new covenant does. Makes your conscience perfect. For the ceremonies deal only with, this is old covenant, the ceremonies deal only with clean and unclean meats and drinks and different washings, mere external rules and regulations for the body imposed to tide the worshipers over into the time of setting things straight, of reformation, of the complete new order when Christ the Messiah shall establish the reality of what these things foreshadow, a better covenant. He said all those things were just to hold us over to the real deal really comes, which came with Christ. But that appointed time came when Christ the Messiah appeared as a high priest. Are y'all following me? Do like this if y'all hearing what I'm saying. Okay. So you get that? So he's saying all these things came into being when he showed up as high priest. When did Jesus show up as high priest? When Jesus showed up as high priest, after he went to the cross, died, rose from the dead, walked on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, and then he rose and went all the way up, and he said, now I'm seated at the right hand of the Father as high priest. At that point, that's when the new covenant was enacted, and everything that's, it's all in the garments. Let me read on. Watch this. When the Holy Spirit came, that was the sign, that was the bell that the new covenant and all the power, all the fruit of the Holy Spirit, it's all here now. It's for everybody.
Amen.
That was the sounding off, that praying in tongues. And that's all in the garments of the high priest. I'll show you that. But that appointed time came when Jesus appeared as a high priest of the better things that have come and are to come. Then through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with human hands, that is not a part of material of this material creation. He went once, Jesus went once for all into the Holy of Holies, not the little place on the tabernacle, but in the true heaven of heaven, not by virtue of the blood of goats and calves, by which to make reconciliation between God and man, but his own blood. He said he ain't no high priest who came with the blood of goats and lambs that would reconcile God with man. He said, no, he came with his own blood. He did much more than that. Watch this. By which to make reconciliation between God and man, but his own blood, having found and secured, here's what he did, having found and secured complete redemption and everlasting release for us. Everlasting release. What he's saying is, when you get to heaven, are you going to have any sickness?
No.
You're not supposed to have it now. It's already been paid for. When you get to heaven, is there going to be any financial struggle?
No.
That's been released and paid for now. That's an everlasting thing that's been paid for you. For if the mere sparkling of unholy and defiled persons with blood of goats, look what he's saying here. If the mere sprinkling of unholy, defiled persons with the blood of goats and bulls and with the ashes of a burnt heifer is sufficient for the purification of the body under the old covenant, he said, if under the old covenant you could get healed and cleansed by blood of a goat, how much more surely shall the blood of Christ, who by virtue of his eternal spirit, his own preexistence, divine personality, has offered himself as an unblemished sacrifice to God, purify our consciences from dead works and lively observances to serve the ever-living God. Christ the Messiah is therefore the negotiator, the mediator of an entirely new agreement, new testament, covenant, so that those who are called and offered it may receive the fulfillment of the promised everlasting inheritance. Since a death has taken place, which rescues and delivers and redeems them from the transgressions committed under the old first agreement. So he's saying this new covenant does much more than just heal you, than just put you in right standing with God. It gives you everything that eternal God has. Everything. It's yours right now. Hit the person next to you. Say, this is much better than you think. All right. Here, let's take a look at it. Just a few more verses, because I want you to see the importance of us looking at these things so you really get it. Let's see. What verse was that? Jump on over to chapter 10. Watch this. Chapter 10, verse 1. For since the law has merely a rude outline, foreshadowing of the good things to come, instead of fully expressing those things, it can never, by offering the same sacrifices continually year after year, make perfect those who approach its altars. He said the old covenant couldn't make you perfect. For if it were otherwise, would these sacrifices not have stopped being offered? Since the worshipers had once for all been cleansed, they would no longer have any guilt or consciousness of sin. Under the old covenant couldn't do that. He said, if it did, there wouldn't be any need for a new covenant. But as it is, these sacrifices annually bring a fresh remembrance of sins to be atoned. He said, because you had to keep doing it annually, right? Because the blood of bull and goats is powerless to take away sins. It just covered it. Your sins have been completely removed. Do y'all get the importance of that? As a born-again believer, God really, really likes you. He really, we know he loves us. He loves the whole world, but he really likes you on top of that. Are you with me? And since this has occurred and you've gotten born again, you can never, ever, God, you have such favor with God that you can never, ever, he can never be angry with you, even when you blow it and miss it. Now, some of y'all are new. How many of y'all have been here less than a year? How many of you have been here less than 6 months? Okay, so when I say something like that, that probably is completely shocking. So let me show it to you in the scripture. Turn to Isaiah real quickly. Isaiah chapter 54. Yes. Good gracious. Go, preacher. I see you. Isaiah 54 comes after Isaiah. Isaiah 53 is the whole prophecy about Jesus going to the cross, right? Talks about by his stripes you were healed, what he did, he took away all your sin. Chapter 54 describes what happens to believers who receive him after he went to the cross. Look at verse, seven. For a mere moment, I have forsaken you. He said that was under the old covenant. I have forsaken you. With great mercies, I will gather you. With a little wrath, I hid my face from you for a moment. But with everlasting kindness, I will have mercy. Temporary kindness. Everlasting kindness, that word in the Hebrew is hesed. It means grace, everlasting grace, right? I will have mercy on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer, for this is like the waters of Noah to me, as I have sworn. God doesn't ever have to swear. It's recorded two or three times, maybe three times, that he swears in the Bible. Why? So we really know, I'm serious about this. God's word, what God says, if God says today is Saturday, we'd be standing here and it'd be Saturday. Like, dang, what happened to the week? Whatever he says it is, right? He doesn't have to swear. His word is bond. But he swears to say, look, I ain't playing with y'all. You get it? Okay, watch what he says here about I swear. For this is the waters of me. For as I have sworn that the waters of Noah would no longer cover the earth, so have I sworn that I would not be angry with you nor rebuke you. After the new covenant, God says, I will never, ever be angry with you again. All right. Now, that isn't to say if you go and rob the McDonald's, because I feel like robbing them right now. I'm so hungry. If the Lord's speaking to your heart to go get like me six Big Macs right now, you would hear from the Lord. I'm just kidding. Okay. Watch. Now, McDonald's would be mad at you if you rob them, but God isn't. All right. He isn't. He's in love with you. All right, because of Jesus, he judges you because of the high priest. All right, for the mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness, there it is, has said again, shall not depart from you, nor shall my covenant of peace be removed, says the Lord who has mercy on you. All right, so y'all see that? Just mark that in the Bible if you didn't know that. All right, now go back over to Hebrews real quickly. We're going to bring out the high priest. We only have to cover two pieces of the garment, so it's not going to take us long, but I just want you to see why we're studying it and why we're going to go deeper into the tabernacle, all the articles and that kind of stuff. On Wednesdays, I'll do that on Wednesdays for the people who want to get it all, who want to go to the next level. Are you? Is that y'all? Okay. All right. Hebrews chapter 10, I was in verse something. Once pure. Verse 5. Okay, watch this. Therefore, when he came into the world, right, he said, this is the Father. Watch what the Father says to Jesus. A conversation between the Father and Jesus. Watch this. Therefore, when he came into the world, he said, sacrifice, Jesus is saying this to the Father, sacrifice an offering you did not desire. All those lambs and all that, you didn't want any of that. Watch this. But a body you have prepared for me, right? This is incarnate Jesus before he comes to the earth. In burnt offerings and sacrifice for sin, you had no pleasure. Then I said, behold, I have come. In the volume of the book, it is written of me. All those sacrifices, all those lambs, all that stuff, the whole book, it's all written of me. It's all describing me, and it's Jesus, that is. Y'all get it? It's all describing Jesus and what you wanted to accomplish with me coming in my body. So all the little stuff, the colors, the details, all describing what he came and did. Do y'all get the significance of this? So it merits our time and study and dedication to understand those things so we understand the new secrets of they're not new secrets, but they're secrets of the new covenant that most people have no idea of, how good it is. Just that simple thing I just told you. Most people don't know that. Watch this. All right. Sacrifice. Then I said, behold, I have come in the volume of the books written of me to do your will, O God. Previously saying sacrifice and offering and burnt offerings and offerings for sin you did not desire, nor had pleasure in them, which are offered according to the law. Then he said, behold, I have come to do your will, O God. He takes away the first that he may establish a second. Takes away the first covenant that he may establish a second. By that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Under the old covenant, they have to come continually to offer sacrifices. Only one person could go behind the Holy of Holies. One person once a year, the high priest, right? Only he could only go once a year. And they had to tie a rope and have all his garments on to make sure he stayed alive. So God's holiness separated mankind from God. Only one person could go. And that's the importance of the high priest. And that's why he's explaining all these. He's saying, listen, under the old covenant, if the high priest was jacked up, God treated the people as they were jacked up. If the people were messed up in sin, drunkards, lascivious, adulterers, messed up, terrible people, but the high priest was perfect, God treated the people as if they were perfect. As the high priest is, so goes the people. So Jesus came and he was the perfect sacrifice. And that's why I said with this, when he stepped up his new covenant, that brought in a whole new order. Now, as he is, so are the people. This is why 1 John 4:17 says, as Christ is, so are we in this world. As he is he healed? Yes. So are you in this world. Is he rich? Yes. So are you in this world. Now, to get to walk in those things, it is a revelation to begin to understand that. All right. Are y'all getting this? Okay. All right. Now, I think we're ready to dig into it and jump into it. Let's see. Oh, there's so much more, but I don't want to read it all. Verse 11. Okay. The whole thing is good. We'll take it another time. Go over to Exodus chapter 28. Well, we'll look. Have our high priest come out. Somebody make some noise for the high priest. Woo! High priest, bless the people as you come. Yes, yes. Come on, make some more noise for him. Make some more noise. The high priest is in the building. Amen. Yes, yes, yes. Pastor Bob is the high priest. Now, we'll have him sit because the Bible says the high priest is seated at the right hand of the Father. And all these things are significant. All these things, all these details make a lot of sense. Now, so we started a couple weeks ago and we'll finish up today. And remember, every detail. I could show you that in Hebrews, but that's all right. But every detail of this clothing is a picture of a truth about Jesus. The high priest is the old covenant high priest, Aaron, is a picture of Jesus. Every story in the Old Testament, every situation, every place, every time frame, there is not one insignificant detail in the Old Testament. Every detail, if you go in Genesis chapter 5, I believe it is. It's Genesis chapter 5, where it just lists the genealogy of man. It is a prophecy about Jesus. Just the names. Come on, y'all know that, right? Yeah. No, let me look. Is it Genesis? Let me just show you, because some of y'all still, you ain't been around here long enough to know what I'm talking about. This is amazing. Watch this. And it is in Genesis chapter 5. Watch this. Genesis chapter 5. Just turn there and circle these names. Watch this. Remember, if you go through it, look at verse 3. I'm just going to go through the names. I'll tell you the verse. Adam was the first name, right? Because he's the first man. And Adam's name means man, right? If you look down the next verse, it says Seth. Seth's name means appointed in the Hebrew. His son's name was Enosh. Enosh means mortal. Next man born is Canaan. Canaan's name means sorrow. Next one is Mahalalel or something like that. His name means the blessed God. Jared was next. His name means come down. Enoch was next. His name means teaching. And then Methuselah, his name means his death shall bring. Next is Lamech. In verse 28, his name means powerful. And then the last one that in this chapter, his name is Noah. Noah, his name means rest. When you just list the names straight, it says Adam, man was appointed mortal sorrow, but the blessed God came down teaching, and his death shall bring powerful rest. That's just what their names mean in the Hebrew. Every detail of the New Testament is talking about what Jesus did. Peace, I love y'all, good night. I feel like I could do that right there. Do y'all get that? So this is why it's imperative when we have a Bible study, that's what we want to dig into. We want to dig in and find these truths. It's not a waste of time just to understand a bunch of Greek and Hebrew. It's to understand what did he have for me? What did he pay for so I can begin to walk in it and not have any more sick days? The Bible prophesies about the last generation. It says it's a generation of righteousness where people, a generation of people will get a revelation that they are righteous and they'll walk in 5 times as much blessing as every other Christian put together. And it's told in stories and in prophecy. It's called the Benjamin generation. And that's why people were saying they thought Jesus was from the tribe of Benjamin, because Benjamin means son of righteousness. Benjamin's whole story is about our generation who understands righteousness. Benjamin was the youngest son born out of death. All right. But then watch this. Come on. I haven't even gotten to the high priest's clothes yet. But watch this. While he's sitting and his brother, remember, it was his other brothers had betrayed Joseph. Right. Joseph is a picture of Jesus. Joseph is the 11th son. Is that right? Am I saying his name here? Yeah. Joseph is the 11th son of the tribes of Israel. Right. He's the 11th son. Do you remember the story? Joseph was betrayed by his own brother. Was Jesus not betrayed by his own? Right? He was cast into a pit, then thrown into prison, right? For a crime he didn't do. Just like Jesus, he was committed of a crime he really didn't commit, right? Jesus was sold out for 30 pieces of silver, right? Joseph was sold out for 20 pieces of silver. Jesus hung on the cross between two thieves. Joseph went into prison with a butler and a baker. Jesus hanging on the cross, one lived, went to heaven, and one died, went to hell. One, the baker and the butler. Remember, the baker died, the butler lived. It's all a picture of Jesus. Are you with me? When he was finally revealed to his brothers, when he sat down, they were in awe, because he said, what you meant for evil, God meant for good. It's a prophecy about us. Anything that happens to you that's meant for evil, God will turn it around for your good. Slap that person sitting next to you a high five. Say, I'm glad I came out tonight. I mean, I know Jeopardy is on. I know Wheel of Fortune is on, but I need to know how to get this. Are y'all listening to me? And that's what it is. There's so much more. I've thought about that. I did a whole series on it called the Benjamin Generation. All right. Now, watch. So we talked about, there's so much of this stuff, Bobby. High Priest. So we started talking about these garments. There's detail. There's one chapter in the entire Bible about the creation of the universe. Two chapters about just these clothes. 20-some chapters over the tabernacle, the articles in the tabernacle, and these clothes and what the high priest put on, the regular priest. Do you get what I'm saying? While the world is trying to figure out the ways of the world, studying the world, God is showing us, no. What's really important is if you understand them clothes right here. That's what it is. But many Christians don't get that. They don't understand that, so they're going through life struggling. And you don't have to struggle. All you got to do is a lack of knowledge that's keeping you from getting what God has. It is not a struggle. He's not holding back on you. Most believers think God's holding out till they do things a little more right. Come on, that was the first lie that Adam was sold. Isn't that right? He was sold a lie. Oh, God's trying to hold out from you. He didn't want you to eat of that fruit because he knows you'll be just like him. Truth, you already are. Come on, give me some high priest. I love this high priest. All right, so we started talking about the closing. This is chapter, Exodus chapter 28 and Exodus chapter 39. We started with these onyx stones. On the onyx stones, stones of fire, are engraved six names on one shoulder, six names on the other, according to the age of dates of the 12 tribes of Israel, right? What is a picture of? They're engraved in these stones, engraved. Why engraved? So they can't be erased. You're on God's strength. Now, these stones are set in gold. Gold always represents in the Bible what? Deity and divine righteousness. So the stones are set in deity and divine righteousness. Your name is engraved in it. That means you cannot be erased from the kingdom of God, right? And set in divine righteousness and deity. And then they made gold straps, these gold chains, they called them. They're twisted and braided. We found out from reading the Hebrew that means twisted and braided in love and divine righteousness, which is attached to this breastplate. And this breastplate is called the breastplate of what? Under the new covenant, under the old covenant, it's called the breastplate of judgment. But see, what that means is you've already been judged as righteous. So the names are on the names of the tribes. The tribes are a picture of the people of God, right? The children of God. 12 names here on his shoulders. The shoulders represent what? Strength and power, and they're chained in divine righteousness to the names in the other place on this clothing, the garments, on the breastplate, or this ephod, the breastplate of the ephod, right? And on 12 precious jewels. And it's listed all in that book. 12 precious jewels. Why precious jewels? Because it's showing, and they're all different. None of them are the same. Why? Because you're individual. You're different from your brother, but you're a jewel to God, set in divine righteousness. The jewels are all set in gold, set in divine righteousness and placed on the heart of the high priest. You're on the high priest's heart. Your name is engraved on his shoulders and on these jewels. You're engraved on God's heart, and this gold strand connects you to his strength. The more you understand how much he loves you, the more you'll walk in his strength. Now, how many of you have ever heard that after you get saved, you can backslide out of the body of Christ? If you get caught up in a sin and Jesus comes, you can go to hell. How many of y'all have heard some teaching like that? Lie! Why these names, why your name is engraved is because it can't be removed. But Pastor, what about that verse in Revelation chapter 3 and verse 5? You can turn there if you'd like. That says that your name, if you overcome, I will not blot your name out of the book of life. I'm glad I asked myself that. Why don't you turn in your Bible so I can answer that question for you? Because when you understand righteousness, people who don't understand that will try to debate those points. And you never want to debate it. They're going to heaven, praise the Lord. If they're born again and know Jesus, they're going to heaven. But you never want to get into arguments about people because they just won't like you, and that's pointless. Amen. You'll find they'll be surprised to see you in heaven. You follow what I'm saying? But God won't be. All right, what did I tell you? Revelation chapter 3 and verse 5. Let me show you that passage. He who overcomes. Circle this in your Bible, so this is a good lesson for you to understand. Once you're in the body of Christ, you can never be put out. Never. All right? He who overcomes, circle overcomes, shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot his name from the book of life. All right? But I will confess his name before my Father and angels. All right? So many people say, well, see, if the way I was always taught years ago, well, you see, the trials and tribulations of life come. Huh? Right? And if you don't overcome, huh, God will blot your name out. Come on, y'all heard that? Hey! Isn't that right? Y'all heard it like that? Come on, be honest with me. Y'all heard that kind of thing. And if you miss it, you get caught when Jesus comes, you backslide, you're on your way to hell. You could have been saved for 89 years, but then that one moment, you're out. Right? And I'm not making light of that, but it's not even logical sense. You wouldn't do that to your kids. Right? But watch. And we are God's kids. But watch this. He who overcomes, and the issue is, well, see, you didn't overcome. And they mean, and they're insinuating the trials of life, the temptations of life, et cetera, et cetera. You stop coming to church. Now God don't like you anymore. Church isn't what got you saved. It was Jesus that got you saved. Jesus, church doesn't make you saved. Jesus is his blood that made you saved, and you believing in that blood. But watch this. What does this mean? Turn over to 1 John chapter 5 and verse 5, I believe. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 5. Yes, yes. John writes about this. Look what he says. Who is he who overcomes? This is a good question. Because it said he who overcomes, his name will not be blotted out of the Lamb's book of life, right? Who is he who overcomes the world? But he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. So how do you overcome? Believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Mark it down so you know. I got somebody hit me on Facebook today. Let me just answer this question because I get, and you're more than welcome all the time to hit me on Facebook and ask me questions. So because you start understanding these truths, it will be shocking to you how good you got it. And I embrace all that. Ask me so I can answer it. But somebody hit me up and said, Pastor, I work at this place and must be like a hospital or somewhere where people die all the time, you know. And she said, it was on my heart to go and minister to this person. But by the time I got there, they had already died. And she said, I felt it in my heart. And she said, she was telling her co-worker was a person who said, well, it don't matter if you told them about Jesus, prayed with them anyway. They got to get baptized in order to be saved. Wrong. Wrong. He that believeth shall be saved. Right? Now, baptism is just like every other obedience. God wants you to come to church. Why? So you learn these truths.
That's good. Say that again.
Because your freedom is dependent on these truths. Jesus, you know, if you birth a child and you never love them. They don't really even know you. They're still your child. Isn't that right? You know, but there's no getting rid of that. There's no unrighteousing you. There, you can't do it. Okay, are y'all with me? All right. So that's why the names are engraved. That's enough of that. And the names are engraved on precious jewels on the breastplate, okay? And it's on God's heart, and it says we studied all that. The colors are very important. Everything on the ephod is always, and everything in the tabernacle, every color you'll read in the Bible will always be these colors. Red, why? Represents man, blood of man. Blue, why? Represents grace in God, right? And purple. Why? Because when you mix red and blue together, it comes royalty, and that's who you are. You're a hybrid of God and man. Red and blue becomes purple. You are a royal priesthood. And everything you'll see when the Bible's describing the priesthood is talking about you. And that's why I gotta hurry up. Hurry up. All right? So the colors of the thing are always blue, white, and gold for divine righteousness and deity. And then purple is in here, all right? Purple. All right. What else did we cover? We covered that. The ephod. We talked about the Urim and the Tumim over the last couple weeks. All that is great revelation. Okay, now I think we're ready, right? Did we cover? Okay, now let's move forward. We only got two pieces of clothing, two or three pieces left, and it's only going to take me a couple minutes. Are y'all ready? Exodus chapter 28. Are y'all learning already? Come on, are you feeling good already? All right, let me take you a little higher. Mm-mm. All right, sorry. Okay. All right. Look at what verse were we on left? Look at verse 31. Thank you, whoever said that. Thank you, Mo. Right. Now, and you shall make the robe of the ephod all blue. Why all blue? Grace, right? Grace. So the robe is all blue, which represents grace. Why? When you look up in the sky, you see blue, picture of heaven, picture of God is the grace of God. All right, we explained all that in the four Gospels earlier on. Now, make it all blue. There shall be an opening for his head to come out, right? Opening in the middle of it. It shall have a woven binding all around its opening. Woven binding all around here, right? All around its opening, like the opening of a coat of mail, so that it does not tear. Why are they so concerned about this blue robe not being torn? Because it's the grace of God. He's saying, no, this grace of God that you wear cannot be compromised. All right? Just make an opening for his head to stick through it. Hit the next one for me. So it does not tear. Okay, let me show you something here. Did y'all ever see the movie The Passion? Yes. There's a Levitical law that says in Leviticus somewhere. Put that one up there for me if y'all got it. Leviticus that says do not. Here it is. Leviticus 21 and 10. He who is the high priest among his brethren, on whose head the anointing oil was poured, and who is consecrated to wear the garments, shall not uncover his head nor tear his clothes. All right? Do you remember this? Turn it over to Matthew chapter 26. Or they'll put it up here for me. Matthew 26. Y'all remember this? Jesus is up on trial. He's before the high priest. At the time, there were two high priests. There's only supposed to be one high priest. Why are there two? It's showing the division in the house of God. All right? Some of them believed, some of them didn't. And it's two high priests, and it's showing the division of that house. Now, when he's standing there, and the high priest, you remember if you watched the movie The Passion, he goes, tell me, are you the Son of God? And Jesus just keeps standing there. Because he's been beaten, he's chained and fettered, and he's just standing there, right? Watch, here it is. And the high priest arose and said to him, do you answer nothing? What is it these men testify against you? But Jesus kept silent. And the high priest answered and said to him, I put you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Christ. I should go into acting, shouldn't I? Amen. The Son of God. Jesus has said nothing until right now, he says. Jesus said to him, he's in chain and fetter, and said, it is as you said. Nevertheless, I say to you, hereafter you will see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven. Watch what the high priest. Then the high priest tears his clothes. Tears his ephod, right? He has spoken blasphemy. He's fussing at Jesus. He has spoken blasphemy. What further need do we have of witnesses? Look here now. Look now, you who have heard his blasphemy. Crucify him. But what is it really a picture of? It's showing this is the finish of the old priesthood. The new priest is standing right there. He didn't know when he was ripping it, but it's showing a changing of the guard. Are y'all with me? Come on, somebody. No insignificant detail in the Bible. None. All right, let's move on. Let's move on. Go back over so we can look at the rest of it. Yes, yes. There should be an opening. Okay, hit. So you understand why it says don't tear it. And upon its hem. Here we go. Can y'all see this all around, Bobby? Of the high priest, excuse me. Yeah, stand up for a second, B, if you don't mind. Here, you mind walking down here? Because here's what I want you to hear. Hear those jingle bells? The sign, watch this. Walk again, Bob. When the Holy Spirit came, it said, this which you all see and hear. The Holy Spirit coming was a showing that there's a new high priest in place, right? With this, when you ring a bell, do you know the little thing that's in the middle of the bell? What is that called? Tongue. It's called a tongue. All right. And now let's read it while Bobby stands here. Some of y'all can't see him up there, but y'all back here can see. Walk on. Just take a walk there, high priest. Wave at all the people. And you can bless the people. Yes. In the first service, my high priest was high-fiving people, like giving them doubt. Like, I said, whoa, high priest. Don't be so cool. No, I'm just like, all right. Now watch this. And upon its hem, you shall make pomegranates of blue, purple, and scarlet, which is red, always those colors, blue, right, purple, and red, all around its hem. Walk up here, high priest, so the people can see you. All around its hem, and bells of gold between them all. Look at this, how specific he is. A gold bell, and then a pomegranate, a gold bell, and a pomegranate upon the hem of the robe. And so you see what we did here, and thank you for Angela Stewart who did this for us and followed the scriptures. But there's a golden bell, gold for righteousness, bell, I'll explain all that, and then a pomegranate. We know it's not a real pomegranate because it said red, blue, and purple. Pomegranates are just red, and it's a very interesting. It is the most mentioned fruit in the Bible, by the way, pomegranate. So red, golden bell, blue, golden bell, purple, golden bell. Red, and it goes all around like that. All right? All right, make some noise for the high priest as he goes and sits down. Now, let's explain what those are, all right? First of all, I brought a pomegranate so you could see this. You all right? How's my time? Careful there, high priest. Praise the Lord. All right, here's a pomegranate. What do you know, what can you see that's unique about a pomegranate? First of all, the color. Color's unique, isn't that right? It's a red fruit. It's the most mentioned fruit in the Bible. And what makes it so unique is what? Y'all said it already. The seeds. Guess what? I did a whole bunch of research on this today, really, and I just found out a bunch of details. I knew some of the basic stuff, but I pulled it up, and there's a whole bunch of writing on it because it's the most mentioned fruit in the Bible. Guess how many seeds are said to be in every pomegranate? It's a significant number. No. Oh, hold up. You can't see it. No, you're all right, baby. You're all right. You can see it's loads and loads of seeds. All right, and this isn't a good one. I got them here. But y'all see that? How many would you, a significant and interesting number that we've discussed in Bible study? 613. Why 613? It's the number of all the laws in the Bible. The number of all the statutes and commandments. 613. Y'all heard me say that? Do you know how do you remember that? 6 plus 1 plus 3 equals what? 10 commandments. 10 equals number. Equals commandment. And they say, read all, any, you do the lookup on it if you want to. Check me out. But they say 613 seeds. They eat this fruit. This is supposedly, the Jews say this is the fruit that Eve ate. Read it. There's all kinds of research on it. It's in the Hebrew, it means apple seeds. Mm-hmm. Apple seeds. So that's where we get that she ate an apple. But they say it was this. In Hebrew, it means apple seeds. All right. What the seeds, it's got so many seeds. Why? Represents what? Fruitfulness. fruitfulness. The Jews say this represents fruitfulness and righteousness. Jews eat this on Rosh Hashanah. They eat pomegranates because it is a sign of fruitfulness and righteousness. 613 of the laws, they would, in fact, the crown, and I didn't know this, or I would have looked for one that had it. And I left the other half at my office. But it has the stem on it is a crown. They call it a crown. And it is, in the Bible, it's mentioned throughout the Bible that Solomon made the pillars in the temple of Solomon, made it the crown. If you look at the crowns today that have those, that's what the crown of this looks like. And so the crown of Solomon was made after a pomegranate. And I read today too that the crown on the high priest's garment was made like a pomegranate crown. Right? It represents fruitfulness on that crown. We'll get to that in just a second. All right. So this represents fruitfulness, 613 seeds. Let's see what else. Righteousness, fruitfulness. All right, you get it? So now that's what the Jews say that this represents. But under the new covenant, what the pomegranate represents is the fruit of the Spirit. The bells represent what? Gifts of the Spirit. How many fruit of the Spirit are there? 9. Good. How many gifts of the Spirit are there? 9. 9 and 9. Same number. 9 and 9. And in the scriptures, they're in divisions of 3. Y'all mind? Since this is Bible study, let's test your knowledge here. And don't feel bad if you don't know. That's why you're here, right? The gifts of the Spirit. And let me just say this. The Bible specifically said, remember what it said, one bell, one pomegranate. One bell, one pomegranate. And it said, alternate them like that around the hem of the garment. Okay? When that woman with the issue of blood, what does she grab on Jesus? She tapped into his fruit of the Spirit and the gift of the Spirit. All right? Now, so there's 9 gifts of the Spirit listed where in the Bible? Yes. What chapter? 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Right? Chapter 12. And there's 3 groups of the gifts of the Spirit. There are the vocal gifts, the power gifts, and the revelation gifts. Vocal gifts. What are the 3 vocal gifts? If you were a charismatic church, you probably know all these things. Word of faith church. Tongues. Prophecy and interpretation of tongues. Good job. Power gifts. Healing, gifts of healings is actually what it says. It's healings. Why? Because have you noticed some people have a gift where they can, they have a gift just for getting people's legs right. Some people have a gift just for specific things. So it's called gifts of healings. That's one power gift. Next. Miracles. Next. Gift of miracles. And one, it's actually wonder-working miracles and the gift of faith. Yes. All right. Then last are the, we said vocal, we said power. The last are the revelation gifts. Which are those? Word of wisdom, word of knowledge, discerning of spirits. Good job. Good job. Give yourself a round of applause. Now, if you'll notice, let's cover the gifts, the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is listed where in the New Testament? Galatians chapter 5. Y'all are more familiar with that. All right, Galatians chapter 5, 9 gifts. They're also in division of 3s. All right, the first, do y'all remember what they are? Just list them in order. Love, joy, peace. Stop. Those first 3 are for the benefit of you, right? Second 3. Put them up there so they can see them. Long suffering. Good kindness and goodness. Can y'all put them up there so they can write it down? Hurry, y'all. Those are for the benefit of each other. Those are the gifts that help you with each other. Look, okay. The one right before that. I don't want them to see that one yet. Yeah. Here we go. Okay, there's tongues. Go back one to the fruit of the Spirit. Back one more. Galatians. For the fruit of the, okay, yes, thank you. All right, watch this. Love, joy, peace, those are for you. You, the benefit of you, right? Joy, your peace, your love walk. Long-suffering, kindness, and goodness are for the benefit of one another. You need long-suffering with the brothers, the brethren. You need kindness. You need goodness. The next three are what? Yes, right up there. Faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are towards God. Faithfulness towards God. You get it? All right, so those last three. Now, notice that in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, they're not the gifts of the Spirit are not listed in order of their threes. They're listed seemingly arbitrarily, but they're not. There's nothing insignificant. They're listed because what he's saying is one gift goes with one fruit. One gift, one fruit. They go together. Watch this. Put that next screen up there for me. First gift of the Spirit listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and is the word of wisdom, but that goes with the first fruit of the Spirit, which is called love. Now watch this. What he's saying is this gift must be tempered with this fruit. That's why he put them on there like this. Why? Word of wisdom. What is the word of wisdom? Word of wisdom, I'll just tell you for time's sake. Word of wisdom is a word from God about the future. Have you ever been in a church where somebody gives a word of wisdom and it's scary? Yeah. God's going to get all those that are in sin and something. It's supposed to be tempered with love. Word of knowledge is a word about what? The present. Yes, yes. About what's happening now. There's somebody in here that God is wanting you to, or you have this growth or something. Somebody may say something like that. They have this growth, but it's dissolving. The way it's supposed to be is they tell you and temper that gift with joy. Make sure you add joy to that. Mm-hmm. And each gift, so on and so forth. Y'all follow me? Come on. That's why it's on this garment of grace, on its hem, how these gifts work are supposed to work, are one in conjunction with the other nine gifts. Y'all see it? Okay, that was all extra. Somebody say amen. We learn in a Bible study. Okay, go back over to Exodus so we can look at this last piece of clothing, and we're done. We're going home. All right? Come on, are y'all glad you came? Does this help you? All right. All right. Verse 36, you shall make... Now, oh, this is interesting. When we first started talking, there was a passage early on in this chapter that says it listed the pieces of the high priest's garments, and it listed them as how many? Somebody said it. Six. Six. That's right. It listed them as six. Why six? Because six is the number of man. However, in the text, it lists one more piece, which makes it seven pieces. But he wants you to know it's six, but it's not just a man. It's a perfect man. Come on, somebody. So it lists a seventh piece, which is this golden crown. All right? Now, and you shall also make a plate. Listen to how he says it. You shall also make a plate of pure gold and engrave on it. And if you look in chapter 39, it calls it a golden crown. All right? Of pure gold. Gold represents what? Divine righteousness and divinity. Okay? Plate of pure gold and engrave on it, like the engravings of a signet, holiness to the Lord. If you read in the Amplified in ASB, it says holy to the Lord. So we have engraved in here, holy to the Lord. And you shall put on it a blue, look at the red, blue cord. Blue represents grace. So on this golden crown, put a strand of grace. All right, so there's grace on this, but watch what it says. That it may be on the turban, and it shall be on the front of the turban. So this band of gold, he's going to explain what the band of gold is all about. So it shall be on Aaron's forehead, that Aaron. Now, who is Aaron a picture of? Of Jesus, the high priest, right? He's a picture of that. He is the old covenant high priest, but it's so as they put this gold on his forehead, why? That Aaron may bear the iniquity of the holy things. That Aaron, the high priest, will bear the iniquity of the holy things which the children of Israel hallow in all their holy gifts. What is he talking about, Pastor? Here. When the children of Israel would come to bring their sacrifice or bring to their gift, to bring their offering, some of their offerings were imperfect. Or they'd come with not a perfect heart, not with a good heart or a good mindset. Let me give you an example of what it is under the new covenant. All right. Have you ever been in praise and worship? Keith and Em all up there singing and just jamming. But here you are in praise and worship. Here you are over here. Hallelujah. She knows she don't even need to be here.
Look at that dress all tight on her. Dang, if she moved, that dress is going to pop off. Praise his name, hallelujah. Oh, turn attention to your neighbor, what?
This, watch what it says. The iniquity, they're offering holy things, but they're mixed with iniquity. They're imperfect. He says, so when you bring your praise, you bring your worship, you bring your service, and it's imperfect, you got an attitude about it. He said, your mind is somewhere else. You really don't even want to, dang, I didn't even want to come to church today. God is saying, look, here's what I'll do. Because they're coming, but sometimes the service that they bring is with iniquity. Sometimes it's they got a bad attitude about it. However, watch this. And it shall always be on his forehead that they may be accepted before the Lord. You got jacked up thoughts sometimes. God says, no, put this and leave this on his head so that they can come and the iniquity of all their jacked upness is on him. What he's saying is even your thoughts, I took care of those. Where does all sin start? Where does all sin start? In the mind, have you ever been condemned and convicted about, you're there and you're like, oh, dang, why am I even thinking this? Lord Jesus, forgive me. God's like, I got you. I see your thoughts as pure because of that golden crown of perfect righteousness. All your thoughts are holy to the Lord. I've made your thoughts holy to the Lord. Come on, somebody. Is this? He's covered it all. And that's what I want you to see. He's covered everything and then put grace on it. Come on. Everything's covered under the new covenant. Now, okay. We're ending right now. You shall skillfully weave the tunic of fine linen thread. Remember, all the garments are made of fine linen. Why linen? No, notice this. This is awesome too. Watch this. I'm sorry, y'all. This is so awesome how it's written. You shall skillfully weave the tunic of fine linen thread, and you shall make the turban of fine linen. So it's this hat. Linen does what? Why? What's the reason for wearing linen? No sweat, to keep you cool. We read that in Ezekiel, right? Turban of fine linen, and you shall make a sash of woven work. The sash is the belt. What is the purpose? Okay, Jesus, the sash is the belt that's around him. When Jesus was having his last supper with the disciples, before he was getting ready to go to the cross, he did what? He took off this belt, this sash, and started doing what? Started washing the feet. This belt is to say, I'm your servant, you're not mine. It's a servant of a belt, the belt of a servant. He bows. This belt is saying, I'm your servant. God loves to bless you. All right, watch this. For Aaron's sons. Now, all up to this point, we've been talking about high priest garments. But then he throws in the middle of this, at the end of this, for Aaron's sons, you shall make tunics for them too. Or tunics. Tunics is the, see all this linen? All this, is they're calling it tunic. Shall make sash and make sashes for them, all the priests they're supposed to be serving, right? And you shall make hats for them. That's the hat. And for glory and beauty. So he said, now look, up until this time, he hasn't mentioned the other priests. He just says, now make for the sons too, belts, so they're serving, and linen, linen tunics. For Aaron's sons, you shall make tunics, and you shall make sashes, and you shall make hats for them, glory and beauty. Next. Almost done. Next. So you shall put them on Aaron, your brother, and on his sons with him. You shall anoint them and consecrate them and sanctify them, and they may minister to me as priests. Last verse. Watch this. And you shall make for them linen trousers to cover their nakedness. They shall reach from the waist to the thighs. As Arsenio would say, on his old show. Watch this. The only mention of the others of the sons, we are the priesthood. We're the royal priesthood. All this time he's been describing Jesus. He says, but hold on. But for all the rest of the priests, the sons, say, that's me. Make sure that they get a servant's belt so they learn that they're serving. And make sure they get cool heads and put them some linen underwear on. What does that mean? From their waist to their thigh. Make sure they have cool heads and cool private parts. Now, he mentioned this about the high priest and the sons. Why the sons? The priest's sons did run into a lot of sexual problems. But what he's telling us is, listen, I've made perfection for you. Your thoughts are perfect. But let me just tell you, if you don't keep your thoughts cool and your sexuality cool, you're going to create some problems. Hit the person next to you and say, nah, I know he's talking to you right there because I just know he is. I know he is. Say it ghetto to him. He's like, I know he's talking about you for real, dog. Stop acting all deep. Stop acting all deep. Close your Bible. That's enough. That's enough. That's enough. Y'all get that? All right. Now, I've taught three sessions on that, so you have to get it all together to get all the details of all that. But isn't that awesome? Yeah. Now, what I want to do is begin getting into the tabernacle and all those things, all that, and start breaking down we had an Ark of the Covenant made that's back there. Yeah. All these things, what they'll do to you is give you insight just like this about what you really have. Isn't that what we need? Yeah. Amen. Y'all receive that tonight? Yeah.